Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Revolutionary Princeton, 1774 to 1783, The Biography of an American Town in the Heart of a Civil War, by William L. Kidder, read by Paul Heitsch. Introduction. Around 9 a.m. on the bitterly cold Friday, January 3, 1777, the terrifying sounds of musket and cannon fire made by several thousand soldiers finally diminished and became more distant. 34-year-old farmer Thomas Clark and his 24-year-old sister Sarah, their 28-year-old enslaved woman Susanna, and 19-year-old French Huguenot farmhand David de la Force, cowering in the shelter of their farmhouse in the Stony Brook community just south of the village of Princeton, New Jersey, all felt tremendous relief. Following their farmer's routine, they had awakened early to start the farm chores that bitterly cold morning, when they unexpectedly heard and then saw a long column of American Continental soldiers and militiamen marching up the little used dirt road that passed the front of their house. As they watched, several hundred soldiers turned left from the column and marched across crop stubble and winter wheat shoots on their frozen farm fields and the adjacent icy cropland and bare orchard of their 41-year-old brother, William. In horror, these peaceful Quakers watched an intense battle flare up when those American troops ran into about 500 British troops coming toward them from the post road connecting Princeton and Trenton. The resulting combat ended in less than an hour, but the fighting had been very heavy near their houses, with an occasional British bullet peppering a wall while they cowered inside. As the sounds of battle became more distant, Thomas and Sarah's great relief suddenly changed to shocked sadness when several American soldiers came to their door carrying wounded, heavily bleeding men, including one identified as a high-ranking officer. The peaceful Quaker siblings accommodated these injured men in their home, knowing there must be more wounded and dead outside, lying on their fields. This short battle was just one event in a decade-long conflict experienced by the people of Princeton that brought them and their fellow Americans freedom from the acts of a distant parliament as citizens of a new nation. Stories of battles like the one at Princeton on January 3, 1777, provide exciting listening, but the often overlooked stories of local people who experienced the events leading up to, during, and following those battles are also compelling and profoundly human. The War for Independence was much more than just a series of clashes between opposing military forces. The American Army that was ultimately victorious and provided the conditions for fruitful peace negotiations required the support of the general population. That army was a continual experiment in military structure, use, and support. Many people contributed to or were affected by the efforts to create and support the military, even though they did not participate in even one battle. Looking back, it is easy for us to pick out those who made the correct decisions. But at the time when those decisions were being made, no one knew what their effect would be. As a fact of life, we human beings live immersed in situations and events that we have little or no control over and must decide how to mold our lives in ways we hope will allow us to survive as comfortably as possible and be honored by history. The chapters that follow explore stories of the people of Princeton between the years 1774 and 1783 to help us understand how the American Revolution affected people of that time, including those whose names, like most people's, don't have a prominent place in surviving history. We can imagine ourselves in their situation or in similar circumstances today, and thereby learn a little more about what it means to be a human being. This story is a case study of life during the Revolution, and the author hopes it will inspire others to develop the stories of other groups of people in different locations. As we will hear, the nature of its citizens and its geographic location greatly influenced the story of Princeton. The cultures, beliefs, practices, and histories of those we live among influence our lives today, and the geographic position of our homes put us in direct or indirect contact with significant events beyond our control. The purpose of this book is to raise questions in the minds of its listeners about their own lives, as much as it is to tell a true, fascinating story, seemingly with only local interest, about the Revolution. The settlement and development of the Princeton area. Just 100 years before our story begins, travelers described the area of West Central New Jersey as a wilderness through which a Native American trail ran connecting the Raritan and Delaware rivers. Europeans began to settle the territory that became Princeton in the late 1600s. James, Duke of York, brother of King Charles II, granted the land that would become New Jersey to Sir George Carteret and Lord John Berkeley in 1664 after the British victory in the First Anglo-Dutch War. Already home to Dutch families, the northeastern portion of that land quickly began receiving new settlers, including New England Puritans, Baptists, and Quakers, who never fully recognized the claims of proprietors Carteret and Berkeley. When his stressful dealings with these settlers bankrupted him, Berkeley sold his portion in 1674 to a group of Quaker investors, including William Penn, who developed the colony of West Jersey, leaving Carteret with East Jersey, which he later sold to Scottish investors. The two proprietary colonies united as one royal colony in 1702. However, the proprietors of East and West Jersey retained significant power. The province maintained two capitals, Perth Amboy in the east and Burlington in the west, and the two regions developed distinctive cultures. East Jersey settlers looked culturally and economically to New York, while Philadelphia influenced West Jersey settlers, both economically and religiously, as home to the Philadelphia yearly meeting that oversaw the West Jersey Quakers. The fertile soil of William Penn's land on the western edge of East Jersey attracted Quakers seeking a place to practice their religion without the fear-inspiring prejudice they had experienced in Anglican England and then Puritan New England. Because the boundary between East and West Jersey was unclear for many years and disputes over land deeds arose, Surveyor General George Keith surveyed and established a province line between the two provinces in 1686-87 to help settle those disputes. The area that became Princeton developed on the east side of Keith's province line, and settlement began in the early 1680s with the arrival of Henry Greenland and his then-son-in-law Daniel Brinson from Burlington, who purchased 424 acres near today's Kingston in 1686. John Horner followed in 1695, purchasing 500 acres located between today's Washington and Harrison Streets. In 1696, John Houghton purchased land, and Richard Stockton, ancestor of the signer of the Declaration of Independence, purchased some property from Brinson. The same year, Benjamin Clark, a native of Scotland living in Piscataway, New Jersey, purchased 1,200 acres on the western side of today's Princeton, and William Olden of Piscataway bought 400 acres from him. Joseph Worth acquired 200 acres from Benjamin Clark in 1697, most, if not all, on the south side of Stony Brook in the vicinity of the mills that bear his name. The same year, another early settler, Benjamin FitzRandolph, came from Piscataway, where he had been a neighbor of Benjamin Clark, and purchased 316 acres between today's Alexander Street and Washington Road from John Horner and Richard Stockton. The region became known as Stony Brook and was a frontier region located between two waves of population advance. One stream flowed west from the area of the Raritan and Millstone Rivers near Piscataway in East Jersey. The other flowed east along the tributaries of the Delaware River, where Quakers had landed at Burlington in 1677-1678 and began settling Trenton, Nottingham, and Chesterfield in West Jersey. The developing Stony Brook-Princeton community, drawing settlers from East Jersey, was advantageously located about halfway between New Brunswick at the head of navigation on the Raritan River and Trenton at the head of navigation on the Delaware River, and therefore midway between the growing seaports of New York and Philadelphia. The main thoroughfare, An old Indian trail, which developed between New Brunswick and Trenton, bisected the Stony Brook land. This road connected with others leading north to New York and the New England colonies, and south to Philadelphia and the southern provinces, providing easy access to markets for farmers' produce and bringing them items required to support their daily lifestyle. The road became known by several names, including the Upper Road, the Post Road, or the King's Highway. The settlement grew as families divided the land between their members, sold property to newcomers, and began to build businesses. The Stony Brook settlement soon stretched east from the Keith Line to today's Harrison Street in Princeton and centered on Worth's Mill. In 1712, Thomas Potts, a miller from Pennsylvania, received rights to dig a mill pond and raceway leading from it, and 2 years later, Joseph Worth sold 6¼ acres to Potts, who then built 2 grist mills and a bolting mill under one roof. In 1715, Potts sold 1/4 of this mill to Joseph Worth and 1/4 to carpenter Joseph Chapman, who sold the remaining 1/2 to Joseph Worth in 1716. Also in 1716, Joseph Chapman purchased from Samuel Stockton 15 acres adjacent to the mill lot and sold it for 1/4 share in the mill complex to Joseph Worth in 1721. The grist mills provided a source of animal feed and flour for the early settlers in the area. The mill pond was a beautiful sheet of water shaded by tall trees on either side of it, located a considerable distance above the mill that local people resorted to for the amusements of fishing, boating, bathing, and skating. After 1721, someone added a cooper's shop. Matthew Clark added a tannery and shoe shop in the 1760s, and by 1767, William Clark constructed a blacksmith shop. As the community developed, the Clark, Worth, and Olden families continued to form a close community of in-laws, siblings, and cousins. The name Stony Brook referred to the complete area of settlement until the village of Princeton received its name in 1724. According to the journal of early settler Nathaniel FitzRandolph, the name Princetown came into use when the first house was raised there by James Leonard in 1724. The name worked well with the small nearby villages established at Kingstown, now Kingston, Queenstown, and Princessville. These names reflected the loyalty to the British Crown that was strong in the area until the mid-1770s. The Stony Brook name then referred only to the southern portion of the development. In the late 1730s, the first bridge was built over the Stony Brook at Worth's Mill, about the same time that a stage wagon began to run twice a week between Trenton and New Brunswick in response to the growing importance of this thoroughfare. The Stony Brook and Princeton lands straddled two counties dating back to the 1680s. The division line between Somerset County on the northwest side of the line and Middlesex County on the southeast side ran basically down the middle of the main street of Princeton Village and, with some variation, for several miles on the same road toward New Brunswick and Trenton, as far as the Keith Province line. Residents residing on land on the north side of the county line lived in Montgomery Township and looked to the village of Somerville, 18 miles distant, for county court concerns. Residents on the south side of the line belonged to West Windsor Township and looked to New Brunswick, 16 miles distant, as their county seat. This division made life a bit awkward for residents when dealing with county political matters, such as taxes, business licenses, and militia formation. However, it provided Princeton the opportunity, if not always the reality, to have more representatives in the colonial assembly than towns existing within a single county. The Stony Brook Quakers, also known as Friends, organized a local meeting to gather at least once a week for services, and their growing community needed a house of worship. In 1709, Benjamin Clark conveyed about 9 3/5 acres to Richard Stockton and others to build a meeting house and establish a burial ground. After many years of holding meetings at Joseph Worth's home, they constructed a meeting house in 1724, and by 1730, there was also a schoolhouse on the lot. When the meeting house burned down in 1760, The men immediately rebuilt it. The Stony Brook Preparatory Meeting was part of the Chesterfield Monthly Meeting held at Crosswicks, where members recorded births, deaths, marriages, new members, and member dismissals. The Friends traveled to Crosswicks in Burlington County to attend monthly meetings, and the road that developed to connect the Stony Brook Meeting House with the Chesterfield Meeting House at Crosswicks became known as the Quaker Road. The Stony Brook Quakers oversaw many aspects of everyday life experienced by members of their community. The meeting minutes contain statements regarding how well love and unity subsists among the members, how evil reports are discouraged, and that endeavors are used to end differences. Not attending meetings brought community notice, and not surprisingly, weekday meetings had the lowest attendance. Constant attention effectively reduced any indecencies in behavior during meetings, but leaders noted that drowsiness was too prevalent in some places. Members who neglected attending meeting more than very occasionally could expect to have to answer for it. Members were expected to avoid playing cards, making wagers, drinking excessive spirituous liquors, administering oaths, and the like. In 1774, it was noted by the Stony Brook meeting that the customs and fashions of the world prevail too much among us. Moderation and temperance is wanting, though care is taken. Couples presented their intentions to marry and submitted to having the appropriateness of their union investigated, and then witnesses attended the ceremony to make sure it conformed to Quaker standards. Problems arose when a member desired to marry a first cousin or someone outside the Quaker faith. On October 5, 1769, Hannah Clark admitted to marrying, contrary to good order, to a man not of our society by an hireling minister when she married Robert White. The problem disappeared when White successfully asked to join the Quakers and became quite active in the Stony Brook meeting. Hannah and Robert lived adjacent to her siblings, Thomas, Matthew, and William Clark, on a lot bordering the post road. William Clark and his wife, Anne, had found themselves condemned in 1772 for being married by a hireling priest and likewise being first cousins. However, they achieved forgiveness and remained in the Stony Brook meeting. People expressing an interest in joining the Quakers went through a process to be accepted. From Stony Brook meeting, widow Hannah Clark requested in January 1774 that her granddaughter, Rachel Hunt, be taken in membership. Catherine Olden and Sarah Horner were appointed to visit her and reported that she proved to be a tender spirit. The meeting accepted her in February. When charging a member with an offense, meeting leaders made every effort to investigate in the spirit of meekness, without partiality, and to seek the truth as the test in judging them. The meeting took care to provide the poor with necessities. In one effort to raise money for the poor, the monthly meeting designated Isaac Clark of Stony Brook to be one of the collectors. If a local meeting came under discussion because of some irregularity in its doings, a member from another meeting might be assigned to help it get back on track. The monthly meeting chose several members to attend the quarterly meeting, where problems at lower levels could be adjusted. Maintaining harmony within the community was a significant concern. Over the years, Stony Brook meeting members Joseph Horner and Benjamin Clark often attended the quarterly meeting representing the Chesterfield monthly meeting. Samuel Worth was assigned to be one of the men to look into the issue of a man accused of having relations with another man's wife, and that man assaulting him on the highway. The quarterly meeting reported to the Philadelphia yearly meeting that worked to maintain consistency among all the preparatory meetings, like Stony Brook. Like all Quaker meetings, Stony Brook received warnings from the yearly meeting to watch for evidence of superfluity of dress, furnishings, and houses. Young women were warned to avoid broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, and young men, needless furniture for their horses. Friends must also guard against being vainly exalted or puffed up, drinking to excess, keeping unseasonable company, falling into debt, going to court to settle disputes, and selling inferior wares. These Quaker farmers and craftsmen were prosperous, but not interested in making a show of wealth or of seeking high office. They lived comfortably, but did not display magnificent homes, expensive furniture, or other signs of wealth. Like other people at that time throughout the British colonies, Quakers often employed indentured servants and owned enslaved persons, even though they were leading the movement to treat slaves as human beings and to emancipate them. Concerns among Quakers in West Jersey about the ethics of slavery first appeared in 1688, when the Germantown, Pennsylvania Quakers wrote up an anti-slavery petition. From that time until the years of the Revolution, Quakers debated how they could enslave individuals of African descent while firmly believing in the spiritual equality of all humans. The debate led to increasing abolitionist expressions, protests, and actions, including among the Princeton area Quakers. Quakers manumitted many slaves, including ones at Princeton, during the 1770s. While early Stony Brook residents were primarily Quakers, Presbyterianism became prevalent throughout the area as the population grew. The Presbyterians were not strongly anti-slavery at this point, and some Quakers may have converted to escape criticism for owning slaves. Commenting on the enslaved people around Princeton, Presbyterian Reverend John Witherspoon, president of the college in Princeton, a slave owner himself, noted rather casually, if not defensively, that Negroes are exceedingly well used, being fed and clothed as well as any free persons who live by daily labor. Some Congregationalist New England families converted to Presbyterianism and relocated to Long Island and then to New Jersey. By the 1750s, members of the Stockton family and some other early Quaker settlers had converted to Presbyterianism, while others had not. The increased Presbyterian settlement in the Princeton area took place at the height of Scotch-Irish immigration from North Ireland, during which about one-third of its population sailed to America between 1731 and 1768, with many settling in New Jersey. Crops grown by the Quaker and Presbyterian farmers in the rich clay loam covering red sandstone on the farms around Princeton and Stony Brook included wheat, rye, barley, Indian corn, buckwheat, flax, and hemp. Farmers also grew small amounts of tobacco for their own and their slaves' use. Economically, Reverend John Witherspoon believed, the productions of New Jersey and the source of its wealth are grain of every kind: horses, cattle, salted beef and pork, and poultry. In times of peace, great quantities of all these are sent to the West Indies and flaxseed to Europe. Never entirely self-sufficient, New Jersey imported tea, sugar, wine, spirits, and all types of cloth. Although an agricultural revolution had begun in England about 1750, it had not spread very profoundly into the British colonies by the 1770s. One New Jersey farmer who was experimenting and looking for agricultural improvement judged that New Jersey farmers refused to leave the beaten road of their ancestors and were averse to running any risk at all. A treatise on animal husbandry published in England in 1775 stated that the American planters and farmers are, in general, the greatest slovens in Christendom. In general, they reportedly did little to restore overworked soil by using manure, crop rotation, root crops, and legumes. Several residents of the Village and Stony Brook area provided services to the farmers as millers, artisans, and merchants, or provided services to travelers, as well as the local population, as doctors, lawyers, or innkeepers. While Princeton was primarily an agricultural community, its farmers and artisans represented a range of wealth, and the village, with its college established in 1756, attracted wealthier people interested in education and a sophisticated social environment. Influenced by the Great Awakening, Presbyterianism had split into Old Light Traditionalists and New Light Reformers, who focused on the need for having a profound spiritual experience, a new birth, to ensure salvation. The Princeton area drew mostly New Light Presbyterians. New Light Presbyterians organized the Presbytery of New Brunswick in 1738, breaking from the Old Light Philadelphia Presbytery. While Quakers and Presbyterians got along very well, Quakers tended to characterize the Stony Brook area and Presbyterians the village. Presbyterianism played a vital role in the development of the College of New Jersey at Princeton. First chartered in 1746 by the New York Presbytery, the college first met at Elizabethtown in the home of its first president, Jonathan Dickinson. When Reverend Aaron Burr became its second president, it moved to his parsonage in Newark. When Jonathan Belcher became governor of New Jersey in 1748, he took an interest in the college and granted it a permanent charter. In 1752, the trustees of the college meeting at Newark voted to relocate the college because they wanted to find a less populated location nearer to the center of the province and more sequestered from the various temptations attending a promiscuous converse with the world, that theater of folly and dissipation. The trustees considered both New Brunswick and Princeton, but the people of Princeton complied with certain conditions first. These included providing £1,000 proclamation money, 10 acres of cleared land contiguous to the proposed college buildings, and 200 acres of woodland within 3 miles of town. Princeton residents who helped bring the college to their village were John Stockton, father of Richard Stockton, the signer, Thomas Leonard, a trustee of the college, John Horner, and Nathaniel FitzRandolph, all large landowners from families that had helped create the settlement over several generations. Each man contributed to the required sum of money and solicited contributions from others. Stockton and Leonard gave 200 acres of woodland a mile or so north of the village, and Horner gave 7 acres of cleared land nearby. The trustees voted on January 24, 1753, to accept Princeton as soon as Mr. FitzRandolph has given a deed for a certain tract of land 400 feet front and 30 poles, 495 feet, depth, in lines at right angles from the Broad Street, where it is proposed that the college shall be built. The next day, Nathaniel FitzRandolph and his wife Rebecca presented the trustees with a deed for a certain plot of land bounded northward by the King's Highway and containing about 4.5 acres for the college building and a president's house. In addition to seeking a Presbyterian college for their town, the residents of Princeton in 1755 obtained permission from the Presbytery of New Brunswick to build a church. However, a delay in construction meant the college chapel served as a Presbyterian church without an ordained pastor and ruling elders until about 1766, when the church building, on land purchased from the college, became functional. Colonial Governor Jonathan Belcher backed the college's move to Princeton and was always remembered gratefully for it. The trustees named the primary college building Nassau Hall in honor of King William III, Count of Nassau, at the suggestion of Belcher when he declined to allow the building to bear his name. Groundbreaking for Nassau Hall took place in 1753, and workers completed its construction in 1756. The Presbyterian schism was a factor in the calling of John Witherspoon to head the college. In Scotland, he had become well known for his new side beliefs and ability to work with people. After he accepted the college presidency and took charge in 1768, one of his first contributions to his new home was to help bring the two factions together. No longer fighting so much with each other, Presbyterians would be free to focus their attention on the problems just beginning to create animosity between the colonies and the British government. Those problems started with differences that arose during and after the French and Indian War. In 1758, Princeton citizens petitioned to have a military barracks built to reduce the use of private homes for lodging soldiers, and the petition was signed by Quaker John Clark, father of Thomas and William and their siblings, along with members of the Worth and Olden families of Stony Brook. While the colonial government did not construct a barracks in Princeton, a stone house that became known as the Barracks on today's Edgehill Street may have served that purpose at some point in the 18th century. By 1774, when our story begins, New Jersey's population was approaching 130,000. It was one of the smaller British North American colonies. Only 4 of the other 12 had fewer inhabitants. neighboring Hunterdon County, with 15,500 people, was the most populous New Jersey county, while Middlesex had about 11,500. For the most part, the Quaker farmers did not get involved in the political discussions and activities that were becoming more and more heated. People were generally content because the province was prosperous. As a predominantly rural society, New Jersey was home to people who were more concerned with what was happening on their farms than with political discussions. Their royal governor, William Franklin, was a colonial, the son of Benjamin Franklin, and generally respected for his actions in office. The focus of the colonial assembly had been more on local concerns than matters of the more extensive empire. However, several Presbyterians of the village were among the leaders in New Jersey of the rising protests against acts of Parliament that affected all the colonies. The very diverse, relatively peaceful farming and college settlement at Princeton was poised, along with the 13 British North American colonies in general, to become immersed in the earth-shattering events that took place during the decade that began in 1774. Chapter 1. 1774. Over the prior decade, many residents of Princeton, like many people in the 13 British North American colonies, had become increasingly concerned about acts passed by the distant British Parliament that affected their lives. The resultant protest actions, however, came more under the heading of news than something in which people were actively involved. The rising tide of protests against these acts reached flood level on December 13, 1773, when protesters acted out their disgust with a small tax on tea and destroyed a shipment of it in Boston Harbor. Parliament reacted by passing increasingly objectionable laws that accelerated cooperation among the people of the 13 North American colonies to resist them. New Jersey had not been an active leader in the early protests, but this was about to change, and Princeton residents would make life-changing decisions when forced to pick a side to support. Protests in Princeton. One night in late January, a few days after Paul Revere rode through Princeton spreading the news about the destruction of tea in Boston Harbor, College of New Jersey students held their own protest against the tax of imported tea. Several boys broke into the college steward's storeroom, took out the winter supply of tea, and then went from room to room, removing all privately owned tea. They destroyed the tea in a bonfire built in the yard in front of Nassau Hall while tolling the school bell and making many spirited resolves. Other students enthusiastically burned effigies of Massachusetts Governor Thomas Hutchinson amidst the repeated acclamations of a large crowd of spectators. Not everyone in the village agreed with the boys' actions, and tempers flared on both sides. Innkeeper William Hick, whose inn stood across the street from the college, drew negative attention to himself by making pro-government remarks that others in the assembled crowd found obnoxious. College senior Samuel Leek became so emotionally caught up that he somehow insulted a college trustee, possibly local lawyer Richard Stockton, who came by and calmly tried to break up the riotous proceedings. Afterward, the Pennsylvania Gazette reported that, "We hear from Princeton, in New Jersey, that the officers and students of the college have unanimously agreed to drink no more tea." This protest differed from the one in Boston, in that the tea destroyed was already purchased and, therefore, not subject to the new tax. Heated debates continued over the following months, and at least some people began to advocate for separation from England through the united action of the 13 colonies, even though they had little idea of what kind of government would develop in the independent country. Each man's first loyalty was to his province as a part of the British Empire, but any concept of a central government structure for the 13 colonies was vague at best. Everyone faced the question, was it better to be a citizen of the greatest nation and empire of its time that they knew, or break away only with the hope that they could develop something even better? New Jersey had been slow to engage in the increasingly contentious protests. However, by 1774, many men serving in New Jersey's colonial assembly found themselves in a delicate position. They were attempting to provide good government for their citizens while at the same time wanting to cooperate with the multi-colony movement protesting questionable acts of Parliament. At the Assembly's February 8 meeting at Burlington, regular legislative business included the presentation of a petition from diverse freeholders of the western precinct of the County of Somerset, praying to be relieved from the burden of maintaining the bridge over Stony Brook at Worth's Mill, just south of Princeton. The same day, in reaction to the multi-colony tea protest, the Assembly agreed unanimously to participate in mutual correspondence and intercourse with our sister colonies. It appointed a 10-man standing committee of correspondence and inquiry to obtain the most early and authentic intelligence of all acts and resolutions of the Parliament of Great Britain or the proceedings of administration that may have any relation to or may affect the liberties and privileges of His Majesty's subjects in the British colonies in America. This committee would work with similar ones in the other colonies to address common issues relating to the collective rights and liberties of the colonies. Royal Governor William Franklin came to Princeton often because of his work with the college trustees, and between April 19 and 21, he attended the first 2 days of a trustee meeting at Nassau Hall. The board appointed local trustee, lawyer, and graduate of the college, Richard Stockton, to examine the school's property deeds to determine the eastern line of the college land so he could direct the college steward where and how far to construct a fence toward the street. Then, in a sign of the times, the trustees examined the case of student Samuel Leek, the student who had recently insulted a trustee at the students' tea protest and revoked his previously designated honor as class salutatorian at the upcoming commencement. The trustees raised their concern that the college kitchen was not suited to serve as the dwelling for the steward. The board wanted the steward, who provided food and other services to the students, to live there and authorized spending up to £30 proclamation money for modifications. They recommended removing the chimney, constructing two new stacks, one at each end of the building with fireplaces on both the ground and upper floors, dividing the first floor into two rooms and the second floor into four, and adding a door between the kitchen and bakehouse. They ordered steward Elias Woodruff, who had come from Elizabethtown and lived across the street from the college with his wife and 6 children, to undertake this work. The trustees had appointed Woodruff on September 23, 1773, to replace Princeton resident Jonathan Baldwin, who had resigned on April 21. Baldwin was born about 1731 in Newark and had graduated from the college in 1755. He received a Master of Arts degree in 1757. Taking up residence in Princeton, he served as steward from 1759 until his resignation. About 1760, Baldwin married Sarah Sargent, born about 1736, daughter of Jonathan Sargent and sister of Jonathan Dickinson Sargent, and by 1774, they had 2 daughters and a son. Baldwin lived on his farm, located behind the college. His farmhouse stood where Prospect House is today. As steward, Baldwin was to maintain the physical condition of the college and its students. Like anyone trying to satisfy the food preferences of college students, he had not always received high evaluations from them. Just before his resignation, when some students grew tired of receiving butter they judged to be inedible, student William Smith wrote that some of the students to be up with him made his image of butter and hung it up by the neck in the dining room. When Baldwin came in, Smith carried it over to him and let him see it, which I believe does not sit very easy upon his stomach. The butter incident was just one rather mild complaint Baldwin dealt with during his tenure. At the other extreme, an arsonist had set fire to and destroyed his barn in 1772. When resigning, Baldwin said he wanted to devote more time to his farm and also participate more actively in the rising political protests. Paul Revere rode through town again in mid-May, carrying news about the Boston Port Act from the Boston Committee of Correspondence to Philadelphia. He had also distributed copies of a broadside printed on black-bordered paper, decorated with a skull and crossbones and a liberty cap. This broadside proclaimed the Boston Committee's call for a ban on all British imports in response to Parliament forbidding ships to load or unload in Boston Harbor until the colony paid for the destroyed tea. The New Jersey Committee wrote to Boston expressing solidarity with its people, while declining, like Pennsylvania and New York, to participate in an embargo on trade with Great Britain. Meetings of county freeholders and inhabitants followed. One occurred at Somerset County Courthouse on July 4. The Presbyterian Church in New Brunswick hosted another on July 15 because too many people showed up to fit in the Middlesex County Courthouse. Both groups expressed their firm and unshaken loyalty to the king and that they were entirely averse from breaking their connection with the island of Great Britain. However, they rejected the fundamental idea that Parliament had power over them because it was contrary to the spirit of the British Constitution and so inconsistent with liberty that we look upon it as our duty to oppose it by every lawful mean and suffer the last extremity rather than submit to it. They decried Parliament's cruel acts of oppression against the people of Boston and established a subscription for their relief. The inhabitants affirmed their support for a Congress of Deputies from the several colonies, a Continental Congress to meet and present a dutiful address to His Majesty, praying for a general redress of their grievances. They supported the idea of a general non-importation agreement and a general non-consumption agreement to be drawn up by the Congress as the only possible measure to preserve the liberties of this country at present in such imminent danger of being annihilated. Finally, each county appointed a committee to meet when necessary to correspond with other county committees and join in electing delegates to the proposed Congress. The Somerset Committee included Princeton residents College President Dr. John Witherspoon, lawyer Jonathan Dickinson Sargent, and merchant Enos Kelsey. The Middlesex meeting appointed Princeton residents John Johnson, John Combs Jr., Jonathan Baldwin, and Rune Runyon to be on its standing committee of correspondence. Former college steward Baldwin was increasingly active politically and also served on the Committee of Observation and Inspection for Windsor Township. The freeholder meetings charged their committees to meet with similar ones from other counties at New Brunswick on July 21. At that July 21 meeting, Jonathan Dickinson Sargent served as secretary or clerk for the 72 attendees. This meeting reiterated the ideas expressed in the county resolutions and chose James Kinsey, William Livingston, John DeHart, Stephen Crane, and Richard Smith to attend the Continental Congress called to meet on September 5 in Philadelphia. The committee also set up a system of voluntary subscriptions to aid the people of Boston. These meetings of freeholders and residents, and the committees they formed, provided opportunities for a broad spectrum of people to participate in the unfolding events and feel a part of them, thus strengthening the protest movement. However, it could not bring everyone into agreement and support. A portion of the population believed boycotts to be an ineffective measure and saw this particular one as a threat to their liberty by exposing them to potential retaliation by people in their community with whom they disagreed on other matters. Adding to the concerns was fear that, should the colonies leave the British Empire, there would be nothing left to unite them, and their significant differences and suspicions about each other would lead to all manner of conflicts and disunity. John Adams comes to Princeton. On the oppressively warm Saturday morning of August 27, several days before the Continental Congress was scheduled to meet, 39-year-old John Adams set out from New Brunswick in a carriage smartly drawn by four horses. Squeezed into the vehicle with him were his older cousin, Samuel Adams, Thomas Cushing, and Robert Treat Paine, the Massachusetts delegates to the upcoming Continental Congress, and also their four servants. After a jarring, dusty ride of about 15 miles over the uneven dirt post road, sometimes called the King's Highway or the Upper Road, connecting New York and Philadelphia, they entered the pretty village of Princeton at about noon. Their driver stopped the carriage in front of the tavern owned by 38-year-old Jacob Heyer, which proudly displayed an image of the literary character Hudibras on its sign. This tavern stood quite near massive Nassau Hall, housing the College of New Jersey, constructed with the light brown, locally quarried sandstone. Presbyterians had brought the college to town in 1757, and Heyer had humorously named his tavern after the title character in Samuel Butler's 1663 mock heroic poem satirizing religious dissenters, such as New Light Presbyterians. The innkeeper greeted the delegates and ordered his staff to help the servants bring in their luggage and move the carriage and horses to the inn's stable area to receive care. Heyer was proud to provide excellent service for both man and horse. Heyer had begun operating the Hudibras, a long L-shaped building of stone with wide porches, in 1768, after leaving another Princeton tavern, the King's Arms. However, the observant Adams may have noted that the building was less than a year old. A fire had ignited in the original building in January 1773, when an enslaved woman staff member went to bed and left a candle burning that fell, unnoticed, to the floor. The flame ignited the floorboards, burned a hole through them, and ignited the laths between the floor and ceiling below. Cries of "Fire!" heard sometime between 3 and 4 a.m., woke up one Princeton resident who immediately arose, dressed, and dashed outside. Learning the Hudibras was burning, he ran there and found the northeast corner in flames without, also the garret within. Boys from the nearby college pulled their fire engine out from its shelter between the college and the college kitchen near the east end of Nassau Hall. Other students carried out two ladders and over 100 numbered leather buckets marked NH for Nassau Hall and set up a bucket brigade. Unable to save the tavern and its winter provisions, beds, and other furniture, they did preserve the detached tavern kitchen, shop, and other buildings by tearing down the covered passageway to the kitchen. The rebuilt tavern had reopened for business in November 1774. So the structure was only about 10 months old when the Adams party arrived. Heyer also earned income as a hatter and farmer. He and his wife Elizabeth Dildine Heyer had 6 children between the ages of 4 and 14. Heyer touted his inn as located halfway between New York and Philadelphia, where stage wagons from both these cities spent the night, and he was able to entertain travelers and others in the best manner. He could also forward for customers any goods or parcels destined for places along the stage route. Coaches arrived from New York and Philadelphia on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday evenings. Passengers paid a premium to ride inside the coach rather than on it. Each was allowed a 14-pound bag or paid 2 pence per pound over that limit. The passengers spent the night at the Hudibras, and the next morning, having exchanged passengers, each coach returned to its city of origin. Adams discovers Princeton. After consuming an early afternoon Hudibras dinner, Adams sought out John Pigeon, an 18-year-old Nassau Hall student from Massachusetts. Adams had a letter for Pigeon from his father, a prosperous Watertown, Massachusetts merchant. In gratitude, Pigeon took his home state visitors for a walk of the small village. Adams did not leave a description of it, but Silas Dean, a Connecticut delegate to the upcoming Congress, was rather unimpressed, or perhaps merely travel-weary when he arrived. He wrote to his wife on another sweltering day, without the least breath of air stirring, that Princeton is a new town, and though the best situated to command a good air, has no good farmhouses and settlements. The college is an elegant building of stone, well calculated and to appearance well provided. The tutors waited on us, but tutors and scholars are the same everywhere, so need not enlarge. The people are neat, and there is elegant entertainment for strangers at the taverns. Shortly after the Revolution, Reverend Manasseh Cutler described Princeton as a small town, or rather, has but a small number of houses in the most compact part, but it is most delightfully situated on the summit of a very broad hill, which descends every way with a long, easy slope and commands a most extensive prospect in every direction. Few of the buildings are large, none very elegant. Although not readily visible to these casual visitors, Princeton was a growing and ever-changing community, hence its appearance as a new town. A year before Adams arrived, graduating student William Richmond Smith wrote to a friend who had graduated the year before and described recent changes in the village. He noted that Mrs. Field had built a very brilliant house between the houses of Gilbert Gah and Mr. Plum, and hoped travelers may not mistake it for the college. William Mountier had built himself a little tower nearly opposite to the Hudibras, possibly to rival it. Smith commented that Mountier's slaughterhouse now sheltered horses. Mr. Plum had installed a new siding on the front of his house and painted it, so that if your eyes are not uncommonly strong when you come to Princeton, you may chance to lose them. Richard Patterson had completed a considerable addition to his house. During the 1773 Hudibras fire, the college boys saved his home and shop by using their fire engine to put out burning embers on its roof. Patterson's next-door neighbor, Mr. Manning, had repaired his old house and built a new one. A little further down the main street stood a newly built home and another recently painted so that now it cuts a flaming dash, and Mr. Potter has made considerable amendments on his castle. Across the street stood the Georgian brick front house rented from Robert Stockton, Richard Stockton's brother, by 31-year-old Dr. Absalom Bainbridge, a 1762 graduate of the college, who had then studied medicine under an established doctor. Originally from a large and prominent family living just down the road in Maidenhead, he still owned property there. Dr. Bainbridge had only recently opened his practice in Princeton, where he and his wife Mary were the proud parents of their first child, a 3-month-old baby boy named William, born on May 7. Leaving the Hudibras and walking south on the main street, Adams and his group passed in front of Nassau Hall. Looking directly across the street, they saw the sign of the college tavern, owned by Richard Stockton and leased to William Whitehead. He had taken over its operation from William Hick the previous April 1. Hick was an Englishman who settled in Princeton in 1763 and began running the tavern in 1767. He made a very successful life in Princeton and acquired a large amount of property that he rented out to various people. However, his comfortable and promising life began to fall apart when his principles and inclination caused him to stand up in loyalty to the British government as the protest debates intensified. After drawing frightful negative attention during the January Tea Party incident, Hick moved to Perth Amboy, where he ran the King's Arms Tavern. Once the war began, he suffered significantly as a loyalist. Opinions about whether or not to protest the actions of Parliament could be very contentious. Even people who agreed that Parliament's actions were improper could still disagree about how to deal with them. To replace Hick, Stockton put a notice in the Philadelphia papers announcing the sign of the college tavern's availability for lease beginning April 1, and describing it as large and commodious, with the addition of a handsome wing on the west end, lately finished, for the entertainment of company on public occasions. Large stables, a coach house, and other buildings were other recent improvements made by Hick before realizing the trouble he would soon face. The adjoining garden and lot contained more than an acre and were well manured. Not long after taking over the inn, Whitehead purchased many items from Princeton merchant Thomas Patterson, including 2 dozen china cups, 2 dozen wine glasses, and several cream pots and sugar bowls. Continuing on the south side of the street, the visitors passed the rectangular 2-story brick college president's house with its gable roof, built simultaneously with Nassau Hall. A 1-story bay extended out from the west side near the rear corner. The windows on the front had flat, stone-winged arches topped by keystones. The front door, surmounted by a triangular pediment, was topped by a small semicircular window or fanlight. It was very similar to Dr. Bainbridge's house, built about the same time and designed by the same architect. Just beyond the president's house, they passed the brick Presbyterian church, where the present church stands today, but with its right side wall facing the street. Two entrances on the outer wall facing Nassau Hall led into the sanctuary, with the pulpit against the opposite wall and the space between filled with pews owned by members of the congregation. A gallery running around three sides accommodated students. Situated on college land, the church also served as a college chapel, and the school had free use of the building during the 3 days of commencement exercises each year. The college president and tutors filled the roles of pastor and preachers. Pigeon's tour then walked the Adams group just beyond the main village to view the home and estate of 43-year-old lawyer Richard Stockton and his 38-year-old wife, Annis Boudinot Stockton. Richard served as a member of the Royal Governor's Council, and the past February 28, Governor Franklin had appointed him to the New Jersey Supreme Court. Richard's grandfather headed one of the families that settled the area in the 1690s and purchased a large quantity of land in the heart of present-day Princeton. Today's Nassau Street was its northern boundary, Washington Road the eastern border, and then it extended west beyond the present Edgehill Street and south to Stony Brook. In 1701, Richard purchased from William Penn 5,500 acres stretching northward from Stony Brook to Rocky Hill and westward from the Millstone River to the Keith Province line. He began construction on a new house, and the family is reputed to have built and lived for a few years in a part of the stone house now known as the Barracks, located on Edgehill Street. The family prospered, converted to Presbyterianism in the second generation, and Richard graduated from the college in 1748 before it relocated to Princeton and became a highly successful lawyer. Annis came to Princeton with her family about 1756, and her father, Elias Boudinot Sr., operated a tavern and served as postmaster for the town. She married Richard Stockton in about 1757 or 1758. Their beautiful native brick Georgian-style house, set back from the main road and probably built in the 1760s to replace an earlier one that burned down on Christmas in 1758, was probably three bays wide and stood one and a half or two stories high. A spacious center hall divided the house on the first floor, with doors at each end and two rooms on each side of the hall. The grounds of the Stockton's estate displayed numerous beautiful trees and flower gardens, supervised by Annis. She named their home Morven, after the mythical castle of King Fingal in the 1762 poems of Ossian, claiming to recount a traditional Scottish epic. She was proud of the avenue of stately elms and lofty cedars leading to the house from the street. Richard had visited England in 1766, where he attended the celebration of the Queen's birthday at court, presented the king with an address from the college trustees, and met with various officials. He also went to Scotland to meet with Reverend John Witherspoon to help convince him to come to Princeton and head the college as its president. Richard also loved gardens and wrote to Annis that, "I had rather ramble with you along the rivulets of Morven or Redhill and see the rural sports of the chaste little frogs, then again be at a birthnight ball." Richard contributed to the gardens by collecting and sending her a charming collection of bulbous roots and other items from England. The plantings, along with their Georgian house, became the source of personal identity for Richard and Annis. The estate announced their wealth and culture while revealing Annis's creative talents. The Stocktons were personal friends of Royal Governor William Franklin, and Richard was among the majority of New Jersey protesters who still hoped for reconciliation with the British government. New Jersey was a colony regarded as lacking revolutionary zeal. Richard's involvement in the protests against the Acts of Parliament grew from his early belief that colonists should elect members to it. Although an official in the royal colonial government, he strongly condemned the Stamp Act in 1765 and aggressively called for support of the Stamp Act Congress in New York, believing the only recourse the colonists had was to petition the king for redress. Because the colonists had no representatives in Parliament, Stockton rejected the idea that Parliament held authority over the colonies. The Adams Party did not meet with Stockton, although he was perhaps at home at Morven setting up legal cases for the coming month in his judicial role, and helping to make preparations for the September college commencement. John Adams discovers Nassau Hall. While heading back toward the Hudibras to complete their tour, the Massachusetts delegates stopped at Nassau Hall, described in a contemporary account as spacious, built of stone, and stands on the highest ground in the town. It fronts to the north and toward the street, and has before it a very large yard, walled in with stone and lime. The ground descends considerably from the college to the street, which gives it a lofty appearance. 2 feet of soil, graded away at the base of the building, made the basement floor just about level with the ground, making the building appear to be 4 stories tall. Adams described Nassau Hall as being about as large as the college building in New York and commands a prospect of the country. It measured 176 feet long and 54 feet wide, with a front central projection of about 4 feet and a 2-story 32-by-40-foot prayer hall extending out on the back. A modest cupola occupied the center of the hip roof. There were 3 entrances on the front, one in the center, and the other 2 near the ends, each reached by a set of wooden steps without balustrades. The basement had 16 rooms, used primarily for recitation, while on the main floor, 7 or 8 feet above the ground, were the dining room, refectory, library, Rittenhouse orrery, planetarium, and the prayer hall. The student quarters on the 2nd and 3rd floors could accommodate 147 students living 3 to a room. Each student room had individual studies for 2 students, each with a window and a 3rd window between them for added light. A 10-foot-wide corridor extended the length of each floor. In 1770, the campus yard between the building and the street was enclosed by a brick wall with pilasters at regular intervals, and a paled fence on a stone foundation bordered the front on the village street. Buttonwood trees were planted in the college yard in 1765. The college also operated a well-respected grammar school, known for its liveliness and Dr. Witherspoon's prize competitions instituted in 1771, in which accuracy and mental alertness were the winning qualities. Drill and exercise occurred so regularly that fluency, such as in the use of Latin, was, in the end, almost inevitable. Witherspoon had made improvements to the college since becoming president in 1768, and it was in the best condition it had ever been in, with good prospects for continued development. He achieved this even with a smaller teaching staff than he would have employed if the inadequate endowment, which he had so far doubled, had been more prosperous. At Nassau Hall, the Adams group accepted an invitation to visit the chambers of Professor of Mathematics and Natural Philosophy, 28-year-old William Churchill Houston. Houston grew up on the North Carolina frontier in a family from Scotland that achieved modest prosperity, and he benefited from the energetic efforts of the community to provide a quality education for its children. Some of his tutors were College of New Jersey graduates who steered him toward it. Houston graduated with high honors the same year that John Witherspoon took office as president, and immediately joined the teaching staff. His first post was master of the grammar school and then senior tutor in the college. Finally, he assumed the newly established position of Professor of Mathematics and Natural Philosophy in September 1771. Houston enthusiastically supported the many changes Witherspoon brought to the college. An acquaintance graciously described him as tall and slender, dignified and graceful, extremely intelligent, grave, serious, and uniform. His style of speaking was clear, calm, free from excitement, like a gentle flowing stream without a ripple or tumult, and yet, by its simplicity, truth, and earnestness, seldom failed to produce conviction. Houston first accompanied the group to the library, which Adams found not large but has some good books. He then took them to the apparatus, where, according to Adams, they saw a most beautiful machine, an orrery or planetarium constructed by Mr. Rittenhouse of Philadelphia. It exhibits almost every motion in the astronomical world, the motions of the sun and all the planets with all their satellites, the eclipses of the sun and moon, etc. The first components of the orrery had arrived on campus in April 1771, a few months before Houston became a professor. The wonders continued as he showed us another orrery, which exhibits the true inclination of the orbit of each of the planets to the plane of the ecliptic. He then showed us the electrical apparatus, which is the most complete and elegant that I have seen. He charged the bottle and attempted an experiment, but the state of the air was not favorable. As they finished examining these famous, state-of-the-art scientific teaching devices, the college bell rang, signifying the time for prayers. Houston walked them to the prayer hall with its gallery and a platform surmounted by a high pulpit. On the walls hung portraits of King George II and former Royal Governor Belcher. 40-year-old college president Reverend John Witherspoon entered the room and led the prayer service in his broad Scottish accent. Student and later faculty member Ashbel Green later described him as of the middle size, fleshy, with some tendency to corpulence. His eyes radiated his intelligence, and his eyebrows were large, hanging down at the ends next his temples, occasioned probably by a habit he had contracted of pulling them when he was under excitement. His dress always avoided the extremes of slovenliness and foppery. On all occasions he appeared graceful and venerable, and people felt his presence, which over his lifespan Green found was exceeded only by that of Washington. During the service, it amused Adams to hear that the scholars sing as badly as the Presbyterians at New York. After prayers, Houston and Witherspoon escorted the delegates up to the balcony, where they had a view of an horizon of about 80 miles diameter. John Adams talks politics. The group walked next door to Witherspoon's house for a glass of wine. The front door opened into a hall extending through the house with a staircase at its rear against the left wall. The library, fully paneled on the fireplace wall, stood to the left of the hall, and to the right was the parlor and behind it the dining room. During their conversation, Adams approvingly found Witherspoon to be as high a son of liberty as any man in America. Witherspoon had established his reputation as a convincing proponent of the cause with his writings, such as his June 29, 1773, pastoral letter to all congregations in the Philadelphia Synod. New Jersey citizens held a spectrum of opinions about how to deal with the current political situation. Some were ready to advocate for independence, while many others held out hope for reconciliation. Everyone faced the challenge of deciding what course of action to support and risked confrontation when expressing their beliefs during social discourse, recalled tavern keeper William Hick. Many people remained neutral or silent, unwilling to take a public stand on the issues. Whether favoring independence or reconciliation, a foundational belief was the need to reestablish a proper power relationship between the king and Parliament. That effort involved challenging Parliament's right to govern the colonies. The colonies were far removed from Great Britain and did not elect representatives to it. Additionally, the king historically had granted certain rights to the colonists in their charters that should continue to define the relationship between the colonies and the British government. Witherspoon undoubtedly expressed to Adams his strong beliefs about the Acts of Parliament. He considered the upcoming Congress to be representative of the great body of the people of North America, distinct from the colonial assemblies and created for an entirely different purpose. It justifiably created an interruption or suspension of the usual forms and an appeal to the great law of reason, the first principles of the social union, and the multitude collectively, for whose benefit all the particular laws and customs of a constituted state are supposed to have been originally established. He believed the great object of the approaching Congress should be to unite the colonies and make them as one body in any measure of self-defense, to assure the people of Great Britain that we will not submit voluntarily and convince them that it would be either impossible or unprofitable for them to compel us by open violence. But the colonies could only succeed if they united for action. Witherspoon cautioned that no colony should act independently to resolve its problems, but always support a union that allowed the colonies to correspond and ascertain how they shall effectually cooperate in such measures as shall be necessary to their common defense. However, Witherspoon was not yet advocating for independence and was adamant that the Congress should profess loyalty to the king and our backwardness to break our connection with Great Britain if we are not forced by their unjust impositions. As for Parliament, he declared, "We are firmly determined never to submit to it, and do deliberately prefer war with all its horrors, and even extermination itself, to slavery riveted on us and our posterity." To get Britain's attention, he believed a non-importation agreement should be entered into immediately. Measures must be taken to promote local manufacturing, and the militia of every colony should be put upon the best footing. An address should be prepared to let the British Army and Navy know the reproach which they will bring upon themselves and the danger to which they will be exposed if they allow themselves to be in the instruments of enslaving their country. Witherspoon creatively recommended that every colony should form a society for the encouragement of Protestant emigrants from the three kingdoms. Also, the Congress should raise money and employ a number of writers in the newspapers in England to explain to the public the American plea and remove the prejudices of Britons toward the colonists' actions. He had worked with newly appointed congressional delegate William Livingston, the future governor of independent New Jersey, to procure an instruction that the tea, destroyed in Boston, should not be paid for by the colonies. Witherspoon described Livingston as very sincere and very able in the public cause, but a bad speaker, though a good writer. Livingston, like Witherspoon, continued to work toward reconciliation rather than independence. Like many others, he feared the consequences arising from a dissolution of the social structure and the political chaos that could result from removing the monarchy. But he ardently supported the challenge to the authority of Parliament. After their glass of wine over political discussions, Witherspoon accompanied the New England delegates back to their lodgings at the Hudibras, took a dish of coffee with them, and told Adams that all his students were sons of liberty. As early as the summer of 1770, students had assembled in their black gowns on the lawn, the college yard, in front of Nassau Hall, and, while the college bell tolled, they burned, at the hands of the public hangman, a letter about New York merchants breaking the non-importation agreement. Witherspoon believed in preparing his students to be community leaders, so his lectures on moral philosophy contained references to government, law, politics, religion, ethics, and history. Almost half of his lecture content concerned political, governmental, and legal concepts, and advocated for natural rights, mixed government, civil liberty, and the rights to resist tyranny. Back at the Hudibras, they met two cordial friends to American liberty, Mr. Hood from New Brunswick, and 28-year-old Princeton lawyer Jonathan Dickinson Sargent, Jonathan Baldwin's brother-in-law. Sargent was an enthusiastic supporter of the colonial efforts to resist Parliament's actions, who had served as clerk of the committee that selected the New Jersey delegates to the Continental Congress. A graduate of the college in 1762, he studied law with Richard Stockton in Princeton. During the evening of this long day, 20-year-old student Samuel Whitwell, another Massachusetts native whose father had sent a letter for him with Adams, met them at the Hudibras, usually off-limits to students. Adams found that, like Pigeon, Whitwell loyally portrayed the college administration as very strict and the scholars study very hard. All students lived in Nassau Hall, and each possessed a print copy of the strict code of student behavior dating back to 1760. Students were required to attend all classes, prayers twice each day, and church on Sundays, card and dice games, frequenting taverns, making boisterous noises, keeping horses, blowing horns, building bonfires, and holding student meetings or leaving town without the permission of the president were forbidden. First-year students, usually about 14 to 16 years old and sometimes younger, had to run errands demanded by upperclassmen, and all students had to tip their hats when approaching within 10 rods of the president and 5 rods of the tutors. The day started at 5 a.m., except in the winter when it was 6 a.m. Trumpets sounding in the corridors awoke students because the college bell had proven useless. Morning devotions in the unheated prayer hall began the day, followed by an hour for study, then a breakfast of bread and butter with milk or cider at 7:30 a.m., a more substantial hot dinner at noon, and later supper, much like breakfast. Adams hears Witherspoon preach. After the long afternoon and evening touring the village and discussing politics with local people, the next morning, Sunday, August 28, Adams penned a letter to his wife, Abigail. He apologized for not writing earlier during his trip because he had found only one opportunity to write and would have needed to send it by the post, but did not want to do that for fear of foul play. He said he hoped to find a trusted person in Philadelphia to convey this letter to her. John briefly described their journey from Boston as being, upon the whole, an agreeable jaunt, providing opportunities to see the world and to form acquaintances with the most eminent and famous men in the several colonies we have passed through. His party had agreeably met with nothing but unbounded civility, complaisance, and respect. Adams mentioned his pleasant visit to Nassau Hall and that he would be hearing Dr. Witherspoon preach that day. He looked forward to beginning work in a day or two, having judged, perhaps a bit too optimistically, that the people he had met along the way universally consider our cause as their own and express the firmest resolution to abide the determination of the Congress. After sealing his letter, Adams walked over to Nassau Hall, where he listened to Dr. Witherspoon all day. Fortunately, he found Witherspoon to be a clear, sensible preacher. Ashbel Green reported that Witherspoon never took notes into the pulpit, but memorized what he wanted to convey, yet not so as to prevent the extemporaneous expression of any thought which occurred as pertinent while delivering his discourse. Manasseh Cutler, hearing him deliver a sermon a few years later, noted that Witherspoon is an intolerably homely old Scotchman and speaks the true dialect of his country, except that his brogue borders on the Irish. He is a bad speaker, has no oratory, and had no notes before him. Still, Cutler believed he was very much worth listening to with attention. This was because, even though the subject might be dry and his delivery required the closest attention to catch his message, the correctness of his style, the arrangement of his matter, and the many new ideas that he suggested rendered his sermon very entertaining. The attention of the congregation strongly marked their regard for good sense and clear reasoning, rather than the mere show of oratory and declamation. After the service, the delegates resumed their enlightening conversation with Jonathan Dickinson Sargent and took dinner and coffee with him before spending the evening talking about public issues. Sargent's son remembered his father as having a cheerful and, at times, even playful disposition, while still having the highest professional eminence and being a public-spirited citizen. The New Englanders found Sargent to be very likable and knowledgeable about the delegates from New York and Virginia, as well as some of the principal lawyers in the middle colonies. For example, Sargent described Melancton Smith as the Oracle of New York for Chamber Council. He described John Moran Scott as an admirable speaker who was like an old man he had known who could set up all night at his bottle, yet in the morning could argue to admiration. Describing another New Yorker, he said James Duane had a plodding body, but has a very effeminate, feeble voice. Of the Virginians, Sargent warned, they speak in raptures about Richard Henry Lee and Patrick Henry, one the Cicero and the other the Demosthenes of the age. Unlike Stockton and Witherspoon, but like Adams, Sargent was one of those men already convinced that independence was the only answer to their concerns. Adams continues on to Philadelphia. After a second night at the Eudibras, Heyer's servants helped the servants of the Massachusetts delegates bring out their carriage, clean, harness, and hitch their horses so they could set off early in the morning for a hot, jarring trip to Trenton. Concerning the roads, Witherspoon noted, there are statutes for the wideness of the public roads, also for repairing, though it is generally poorly done, yet from the climate and the level position of the country, the roads are excellent in summer. Excellent was a relative term and did not imply that traveling was comfortable, but merely that the roads had fewer problems and dangers than in other seasons. As they departed the village, the delegates passed Morven on their right and then saw to their left the old stone house known as the Barracks that had been the original Stockton home before Morven. This house was 90 by 25 feet and two stories. The first floor had five rooms with fireplaces and six rooms on the second floor in addition to rooms for servants. It was not a pretentious home, but very utilitarian. The property also had a kitchen garden, a Dutch-style barn 40 by 40 feet, a stable for cattle, a wagon house, a cider house, and other outbuildings. Continuing south, they entered that part of the community known as Stony Brook, which had begun as a Quaker settlement and was still home to some extensive Quaker families, interspersed with several Presbyterian families. Witherspoon once described the road to Trenton as a continued and gradual descent from Princeton to the Delaware River. Other travelers noted the land was mostly level, but with some long hills, and some parts were covered with trees, but far greater part of the country was without woods, and there were very extensive fields of grain on both sides of the road. Traveler Peter Kalm noted that around Princeton, the woods were likewise more cut away and the country more cultivated, so that one might have imagined himself to be in Europe. Trees throughout the Princeton area included oaks, ash, maple, birch, chestnut, walnut, pine, and locust.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.